Okay, so when we looked into the contextual bandits initially, especially the stochastic version, we made an assumption that my mean rewards are all linear in the context, right? And we then tried to solve that problem by building an algorithm that especially uses the confidence ellipsoids. So the main problem there was how to construct the confidence ellipsoid. So in that problem, what we assumed in the stochastic case, we assumed that there was a fixed parameter theta star. And if you are going to play an arm x, so arms were there like vectors. If you play some x, you said the mean reward you are going to get is x transpose theta star, right? So we said that the rewards were linear in some unknown parameter theta star. Now we will move to the adversarial version of that, in which this theta star need not be fixed and unknown. Yes, like it is unknown. Earlier in the stochastic case, it was fixed. But now we are going to consider a setup where this theta could be selected by an adversary in an arbitrary fashion. So then what could be the learning setup? Okay. So we are going to study adversarial linear bandit. So what we are going to assume is like, okay, let's say you have an action set A, which is a subset of RD, and this is how the game setup in whatever the in each round is that fine. So the sequence of YTs is selected by the environment, and now you have to select an arm in that round, and by selecting an arm AT, you are going to get a reward which is the inner product of this AT and YT. Okay, so just to compare, and naturally your goal is to maximize your reward, cumulative reward. So I am just going to consider the loss setting here. Let me call this as loss. So this is like loss. So this is what, if you know the sequence of let's say y1, y2 all the way up to y capital T, what does this give you? So this will give the best loss you would have incurred in hindsight, right? If you have known all y1, y2, we are now looking for what is the action I should be playing so that over this sequence I get the smallest loss. And what is this part? This part is like you are playing some AT in round T, and this is the loss actually you are incurring, and this is the total loss you have incurred. Okay, so this is for a given sequence y1, y2 all the way up to yt. So then why this expectation here? Yeah, so the learner could select this ATs in a random fashion. Okay, so the randomization, this could be randomly selected. Okay. So now we are interested in this algorithm, in this setup where I want to minimize this regret. Okay. So let's say initially my A is finite. That is my set of actions is finite. Okay. And let's say further as a special case, let's say I am going to set A to be P1, P2 all the way up to ED. If I have this setup, what is this setup then? If what is this? This is the standard adversarial bandit we have, which we have already studied there, right? Like in every round, the adversary is going to assign a reward. So here I am saying this is a vector, right? Like in the K-arm adversarial setting we had, we said that the adversary is going to assign reward or loss to each of the arms. Whichever you are going to pick, you are going to observe only the loss from that arm, others you are not going to observe. So here you are going to pick a particular AT, that is one of these unit vectors, then you are only going to observe that component of YT and that is the loss you are going to incur. And this is simply which is the single best RM you want to pull in hindsight, right? Because A's are all coming from that unit vectors, that is just cell, which is the single best arm I should be. So this, in that way, this is just like a generalization of your K-arm adversarial setting. Okay, but now you are allowing the environment, anyway it is going to choose a vector YT, but now I am allowing the learner to play these actions AT, which are not just unit vectors, it could be any subset of RD. Okay, so for time being, henceforth, I'm going to only focus on the case when cardinality of this A is less than, if this is finite, then we will discuss what happens when this is not the case. So before we continue, we are going to make the following two assumptions. One, for any so what this says, take any Y, that is Y that is selected by any by the adversary or the environment. For playing any action, the reward you are or the loss you are going to see is bounded by 1. So this is, we are just making sure that the losses or the rewards, they lie in the interval 0, 1. Okay, so this is like equivalent to like when we did stochastic case, we assume that the means are in the interval 0, 1, right? So the are the supports are in the interval 0, 1. So we are making just the same assumption. If this is not the case, then you just scale everybody appropriately so that you bring down the rewards at any round to be in the interval 0, 1. So if this is not the case, your algorithm will just scale by whatever is the maximum loss you are going to incur in any of the rounds. Okay, this is fine. Other thing I am going to assume is the action set spans RD. Or I am going to assume that A is the basis for, forms a basis for my RD. Okay, so I will see that we are going to use this assumption when we are going to have a derive the regret bound for this setup. Okay, so this will just like this assumption also make sure that since it spans RD, I want to like. So this helps me to explore all possible directions of my YT vectors, whatever I am going to say. Like so each of the terms I want to explore well. That's why that will If this is the case, I can achieve that target. Okay, fine. So, okay, now is the setup clear for this adversary linear bandit? This is the setup we have. Under this assumption, now what is a good algorithm to minimize this regret? Now, what is that? So, can you think of any algorithm, any generalization of the algorithms we already know? Okay, we already know when this special case, when my action sets are all just the unit vectors, we already know how to solve this problem, right? I am going to simply use like exp3 or exp3ix, whatever algorithm. Now, we have just a generalized version of this. What could be a good algorithm? So, when we studied this exp3, there the main thing for us was how to estimate the losses of each of the actions in every round, right? Like the for some actions which I actually played, I observed the reward or loss. For the ones which I didn't observe, I didn't have any information, but still in that round I want to estimate the losses for each of the arms in that round. Now, the arms have been replaced by my action set here. Similarly, I want to do like the same thing. In every round, I want to estimate the loss I would have observed for each of my actions. And that is possible for me if I can estimate what is the YT that would have occurred in round T. So, if you somehow figure out what is possibly potentially the YT in round T, you could just go and find out for each action what is the loss you are going to incur, and from that you can go to player 1 which has the smallest loss, right? But the question now boils down to how you are going to estimate that YT in any given round. Okay, so for that, if you want to estimate, we also want to ensure that whatever we are estimating is unbiased, the way we did it in using the importance sampling method. So, now we are going to now discuss about how to do this. Suppose you could figure out So, let this denote the loss, the estimated loss for action A in round S. So, this is an estimated value in round S for the loss incurred for action A. Suppose if I can estimate this for all the actions A. So, then what would be how you are going to play an arm in that round? So, we can do that exponentially weighted distributions, right? So, in that case, we know that that has a better properties, right? Like we have been using it many times in our exp3 algorithms. So, then we want to construct a function in round T that will give me a probability distribution, and we know that one particular way to do this is so this is what like the exponentially weighted probability distributions we have, provided we could estimate the losses I am going to incur for each of my actions in that round. Yeah.
Sir, if this action set it spans RD,
yeah,
we can do a transformation such that the like the space of these vectors,
yeah,
basically they will get transformed into like orthogonal vectors, like yeah, basically a basis orthogonal basis functions, and then we can the reward this YT what we are, whatever we are getting, we can separate it out into components in these directions. And then wouldn't this be the similar setup?
Okay, so that again, so like you're saying, if you have this action set, if that can span,
they may be correlated. These actions may be correlated.
Yeah, the actions is good, but you are saying I can always come up with, I will transform them and try to get this basis vector.
Yes.
But then you can map the losses 1-to-1 in that case. So suppose let's say I have some action A, and I. Okay, and let's say this A hat here is your transformed basis.
The cardinality of the action set is D, or is it more?
It could be more. Only dimension is D. It could be large. I only said A is a subset of RD. I didn't say it has exactly D elements in it. This is just a special case where it had exactly D elements in it. Okay. So I don't see like how you can just restrict any of this action space to a particular to a basis, and then you still be able to do a one-to-one mapping between the loss for a particular action from this and a loss and map it to a particular action in the transform space. Okay, so I don't see that, but let's see how to just do with whatever we are given. So we are given an arbitrary subset of RD, and this constitutes our action set. So now we know that if you go with such a probability distribution, we have already seen that okay, even though it gives us an unbiased estimation, like in the EXP3 setup I'm talking about, but we saw that its variance could be very bad. So the way we handled that bad variance, how did we handle that? In introduce comma, otherwise we also deliberately include an exploration term there, right? Okay, so let's say, so one thing we can possibly do is I can come up with, instead of just going with like this, we can go like so pi I is going to be my exploration distribution. We will specify how it looks like. So once we could do this, then I am going to, once I can construct like this, I am going to simply pull an action AT which is drawn from this distribution, play it and observe whatever the reward in that corresponds to that. So fine. Now what remains is, okay, how to estimate this? If I have this, I can do everything. Now how to do this? One possible way to estimate my yt in round t is, let's see, in this I'm going to just yt. And what is yt here? Yt is the loss. Okay, so let me just repeat y. Okay, so let's see this. Suppose I'm saying that, okay, let's say in round t, you played an arm AT and you observed this reward YT. Okay, so once you play going to AT, whatever been observed, whatever been the selected by adversary YT, you are going to observe the inner product of this, let's call this AT. So if I want to estimate my YT hat based on this, now what is unknown for me is this RT is a thing which is not specified here. Now how can I make this YT hat unbiased? How should be I choosing my RT? Okay, suppose now let's say, okay, Let me take expectation of suppose yt hat, given all the things we have observed, all the things. So a1 all the way up to t1, t minus 1 is the action you have already played till t minus 1. This we already know. This you have done before time t. Conditioned on this, yeah.
So what is at? At the arm we are picking.
Yes.
So, what is 18 times
5? This is a scalar, right?
Yes.
This is a vector. And now I want to construct a matrix RT. So, 18
is the nervous selection action.
18 is what the learner selected in round T, right?
The distribution or the.
It's the actual action. The actual action played in round T. Yeah, the d-dimensional action. So he is going to select an action at from A, right? He, according to some distribution, he has selected, but he has selected that. What is just a scalar? Because it is just an inner product. What is the multiplying? Yeah, this is scalar. That's fine. That's fine. What I'm saying is, okay. Now this RT, I want to come up with. This is going to be what? Yt is d dimensional, right? Let me say d cross d. How should I select my rt vector in round t so that this guy, conditioned on what I have observed so far, this becomes an unbiased estimate of my yt. See, yt t hat is what? This is an estimate for yt. I am just trying to estimate this quantity yt. This is the estimate for entire yt, small yt.
So, you think that yt hat is the, okay, so then how will that work out, that THP minus? So, where you are summing up?
No, components. Sorry, this is for each action, right? This is ys of hat of A. So, this is for one particular A. This is the probability of selecting A with this. This is proportional. So, if you want exact, you can just normalize, which happens to be the just sum of all these quantities. Okay. So, now suppose I take this RT. Now, what is random here? AT. Okay. So, before I write this, so if I just simplify this, this is going to be RT into AT, and what is YT? YT is nothing but AT transpose YT. So I just replace this whatever YT that I am going to observe in round T, but by its definition. Okay, so now this quantity is nothing but RT. Now, expectation of what are the random quantities at this point is AT, AT transpose and YT. Right. So, right now I am not as specified. I am just whatever it is, I am going to choose this RT deterministically in round T. We will see what that is going to be. And the expected value of this YT hat, this estimate condition on this, is simply going to be RT into this, because the condition is okay. So, this condition, this quantity is conditioned that I am. So, when I say T, this means this I have already conditioned on all the quantities I have observed so far. So, this quantity here RT, I am going to write it as so conditioned on A1, A2 all the way up to AT minus 1, I already know what is my quantities, these probabilities, PT of A. And then this quantity is then nothing but expectation of this quantity is nothing but you just take their values and multiply with the corresponding probabilities, right? So I'm just now for this AT and AT transpose, I'm just replacing for particular A and AT transpose, and I'm now going to consider expectation with respect to the distribution PT of A. So A is what? A is the action, one of the action in my action set A. I'm just looking for all possibilities of AT, AT and transpose. I'm going to pick them according to this distribution PT of A. A1 into, no, this is conditioned on that because PT of A depends on all this observation. But this does not, YT, and as I said, RT, I'm going to choose deterministically in that round. I have not yet specified. Now, if I want to make this estimate here, YT hat, and I unbiased estimator of this quantity YT, how should I be choosing RT? So then if I choose RT to be just the inverse of this matrix, then this estimate becomes unbiased estimator for YT, right? So let's choose this quantity to be, I'm going to denote this as, so as we said, this PT quantity here could depend on the exploration distribution I have set. So that's why let me call this as this whole quantity as Q of pi. Then if I set my RT to be equals to Q of pi inverse, then my expectation of T YT hat is going to be T. So when I say expectation with subscript T, that means conditioned on this quantity. So I'm just so now you have kind of have built up an estimator for your YT. If you have kind of built an estimator for YT, you have done this job now. Now you can just repeat the process, right? Okay, now let me write down the exact algorithm now. So this is the general idea. What? Yeah? So intuitively right here, right? What do you want? Like as I said, if I can somehow estimate the losses for each actions, then I could just follow whatever the idea I was following. About that, yes? Yeah. This particular form, this is basically coming from the intuition of what we did it in the least square regression, right? How did the least square regression work? What was the estimate? We estimated theta hat to be what? V inverse of, okay, so how did our theta t hat work out? In the stochastic case, one to t. You recall this? So this is our estimator in the least square regression, right? So this was what? As is the action you played in round S. Now we know that in this case what? we have a fixed theta star from which all these rewards are correlated through. Okay, so that's why we all these rewards are correlated. So we use all the information we'll have till round t, all from s1 to t. So now what? When I am going to use adversarial one, there may not be correlation across theta t that the adversary is selecting. So the theta star need not be the same, right? It could be changing in every round. So I will only focus on one round. That is what I don't have summation here. And for that, just try to use this idea. So now if you just ignore for all of them, then for a single one, it is going to look like AS transpose inverse, and then it is going to ASRS, right? If you have to deal with only one term here, that is exactly what we have used. But instead of directly writing it like this, we just wrote like this and just saying that to get an unbiased estimator of my yt hat, the way you have to choose rt is like this. Okay.